Perhaps the most difficult thing a human being called upon to face is long concentrated thinking. Those words were written in 1925 by Hugo Gernsback, a prolific inventor and one of the pioneers of science fiction. And distractions lurked everywhere he looked. Street noises filtering through the window, a door slamming somewhere, a telephone ring, or a doorbell. So the Gernsback invented the isolator, a wooden helmet that eliminated the 95% of the noise from the outside world, fitted with two tiny glass windows for the eyes, and an easily attachable oxygen tube in case you ever struggled to breathe. It was an imperfect solution to a very real problem: how to focus in busy modern world. 100 years later, the struggle to focus has only gotten worse. Isolation helmets have been replaced by noise-canceling headphones, productivity apps, and digital blockers, and an entire industry of self-proclaimed productivity gurus who offers hacks to improve your mental performance. But distractions have evolved too, email becoming more sophisticated, more personalized, and harder to escape. Every day, it feels like resisting them takes even more effort. So what we supposed to do? How do we focus? Before we can find the answer, we first need to understand how well we can focus. Here's a quick test. Ignore the people in the foreground and focus only on the guy in the back. Your task is to count exactly how many times he jumps on the trampoline. Ready? Go. How many jumps did you count? If your answer is 11, congratulations, that's correct. But did you see the gorilla? The one that quietly stepped into the frame and then tiptoed away? The first version of this experiment was first conducted in the 1990s, but with a much bigger gorilla. Surprisingly, about half of the participants completely missed it, which means that if you are super focused, you won't notice what's going around you. We can become blind to everything else happening around us. The world around us is shaped by what we are paying attention to, and
you might think you can watch this video while texting a friend or cooking dinner, but you can't.
We are not wired to multitask. Writing an article while talking to phone, while looking at an email inbox, that's impossible. The term multitasking comes from the computer world, first used in the 1960s to describe machines that could process two or more tasks at once. But the truth is, most computers can't even do that. Let's say you have four or five different programs running. It's not literally running those programs at the same time. It's quickly switching between tasks, making it appear as if they're handling multiple things at the same time. The same is true for our brains. All the things we want to focus on are like different programs running at once. This includes things in our mind, like your to-do list for tomorrow. You might think you're handling these tasks at the same time, but in reality, you're switching between them. And we're not as good at it as computers. It takes our minds a while to truly shift focus from one task to another. And during that time, we can't fully focus on anything else. So the key to focus is to keep one program, and only one program, running as long as possible. Research suggests that we can focus on one task for about 90 minutes at a time. Some time management apps have a unique insight into this issue, as they track how tens of thousands of people actually spend their time. On average, adults in the US check their phones 352 times a day. And that's about once every 3 minutes. The real issue is that we constantly check our inbox, not because we lack willpower, not because of a bad habit, and not even because we're addicted. As social creatures, we are hardwired to work in groups and feel a deep need to stay connected. We go to great lengths to avoid letting others down. Logically, we know it's okay to reply later, but a deeper part of our brain says, no, someone needs us and we're ignoring them. Online, there are a lot of productive gurus fighting back with techniques that often sound pretty complicated.
We're going to talk about the 80-20 rule.
The Pomodoro technique.
The block schedule system. It's going to blow your mind.
Insert friction points.
Eat that frog.
But beneath all the jargon, most of their advice boils down to a few simple strategies. Structuring your day so you spend less time deciding what to do and more time actually doing it. Taking regular breaks to restore energy and prevent burnout. And what gurus call
batching.
Batch email.
This simply means checking your email a few times a day instead of every few minutes. And while studies show this approach can make people a bit more productive, if you're naturally more anxious or neurotic, it might actually increase your stress rather than reduce it. Clearly, these tips have not solved the problem we have with staying focused. The problem is deeper than that. Some news reports even claim that our attention spans are fundamentally broken. It's often said that humans now have a shorter attention span than a goldfish. But if you actually trace the source of that claim, there's little real research to back it up. In fact, we've heard this kind of panic before. When TV became popular, people feared it would rot our brains. Decades earlier, the same was said about radio. And centuries before that, critics worried about books, claiming that mass printing would weaken the judgment of scholars. We may feel more distracted today, but that's hard to measure. Researchers often use working memory capacity as a way to gauge attention, and studies show it has remained stable since the 1990s, long before smartphones. In fact, scientists have struggled to find any evidence that our ability to focus has changed since the late 1800s. It's not that our minds have been weakened by smartphones, TVs, or even books. While these can be distractions, they aren't the biggest one. It's your mind itself, which is something even an isolator can't fix. The right way to understand what's happening now isn't that we've lost the ability to focus, but that we've simply become out of practice. Out of practice at feeling that urge to do something else and resisting it. It's like a runner breaking through the wall. Once you push through, the urge fades and your attention stays. The difference is you need to sit still, focusing on something simple like your breath. When your mind starts to wander, gently bring your attention back to it. This practice helps you become more aware of your thoughts and feelings without getting overwhelmed by them. It also helps you relax. When those distractions come up, you'll have stronger mental muscles to pull yourself back in. Instead of strengthening these muscles, though, a lot of people have been opting for a different approach: getting rid of the urges. A big part of focus is motivation, the inner drive to achieve something rewarding. Today, technology gives us quick rewards at the touch of a button, making it harder to resist distractions. So, if we're going to have any chance of resisting these distractions, you have to know what you want to do instead. That requires reflection, experimentation, and time, and it's often uncomfortable. In the past, the answers to these questions might have come more easily from religion, family, or community. There were clearer obligations and fewer choices, making it easier to stay focused on what mattered. The more tasks you switch between, the more your mind slows down. Focusing always comes with a trade-off. You gain the ability to accomplish something, but at the cost of missing out on other things happening around you. You become blind to everything else happening around you. Our minds don't actually work like computers. It's an infinitely more complex system that can't be optimized for efficiency with a handful of bug fixes. All you can do is keep practicing to improve it. The more you work on building your focus, the stronger and better it will become over time. So, next time you find yourself feeling lazy or distracted, just remember this video and take action.